online, they were on YouTube. Do you want to say hello to one another?
Hello.
Taken from Psalm 103. Praise the Lord, my soul, all my innermost being. Praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits. He gives all your sins and heals all your diseases. He redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion. He satisfies your desires with good things so that you renewed like the eagles. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and the kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you, his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you, his servants, who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works, everywhere, in his dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul. The reason why I chose Psalm 103 as our call to worship this morning is it links right into our first song. The first song, O Lord, you've done great things, and I will praise you. It's taken from this chapter. Karen and Lucy, who wrote it, is a good friend of ours. And she wrote this as an act of worship. And so as we sing it, and as we come together, let's begin our worship this morning. And remember, the Lord is in the church. He knows he's awesome. He's looking for you to surrender yourself to him. Why do you think he never picked anyone the world would ever pick? Why do you think he took the shepherd first? Why did he call a sinner like Peter to be his disciple? Or a boy to slay a giant? He's looking for people who seek after him and put him first and centre of their lives. All he's looking for is for you to look for him. All he wants is everything. He's looking for people who will touch it, who will feel his touch and go, turn off the TV and all the distractions that replace him, and spend time with him. It matters who carries the ark and it matters how they carry it. It matters. You may be saved, but there's much more to be trusted with. He wants to be closer. He doesn't want you to just make it in. You can live with him now. He's looking for lovers who pay attention to the whisper of the Holy Spirit, who are willing to sit in the discomfort of the silence and wait on him. He's not looking for your talents or how qualified you are. He's looking for your surrendering of yourself to him. On the last day Jesus had before he was arrested and crucified, that evening, just a few hours before he was arrested, he took off his outer garments, wrapped a towel around his waist, and washed his disciples' feet. He humbled himself, took on the position of the lowest servant, and served others as an example. He was the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He should have been clothed in the glory of old, but no. He surrendered himself to mankind and offered himself as a sacrifice for all. Smith Wigglesworth said in 1927, "How can I submit myself to God that he shall have royal preeminence, but I will not refer to myself, but that he shall be glorified?" Challenging words. I'll take up our offering as we sing this next song, "Our Upward My Life."
Surrender on the street, quietly come. trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your path straight. And now from Acts chapter 26, St. Paul is speaking. On one of these journeys, I was going to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priest. About noon, King Agrippa, as I was on the road, I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, blazing around me and my companions. We all fell to the ground, and I heard a voice saying to me in Aramaic, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads." And then I asked, "Who are you, Lord?" "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," the Lord replied. "Now get up, stand on your feet. I have appeared to you to appoint you as a servant and as a witness of what you have seen and will see of me. I will rescue you from your own people and from the Gentiles. I am sending you to them to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me." So then, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the vision from heaven. First to those in Damascus, then those in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and then to the Gentiles, I preached that they should repent and turn to God and demonstrate their repentance by their deeds. That is why some Jews seized me in the temple courts and tried to kill me. But God has helped me to this very day. So I stand here and testify. I stand here and testify to small and great alike. I am saying nothing beyond what the prophets and Moses said would come. What the prophet said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer, and as the first to rise from the dead, would bring the message of light to his own people and to the Gentiles. Here ends the lesson.
Next song. This is my desire.
Thank you.
shower because music blaring out and this question gone. And as parents, so even now this certain point. Lord, as I pray that you bring me more like, as it brings your voice to smile. Lord, anoint his words. Speak freedom to us, Lord. Give us ears to hear. Spirit speaking to us this morning. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Somewhere I have my weeping. Jump in. She had to put the Bible reading in very large letters. Till Friday, when I go and, God willing, my eye is restored by the grace of God. It will be so. But this morning, I want to look at what it means to really surrender. We all say that we surrendered to God, surrendered to Christ when we gave our heart to him. But have we totally surrendered as the church fathers believe we should surrender? There was a sect in 5th century Israel and in the church called the Essenes. And they believed in total surrender. They went even so far as to separate themselves from everybody else because they wanted to be this separate people. Is that what God's calling us to do? I would say no, he's not calling us to separate us from our fellow men and women. But he is calling us to totally give our lives over to him. When we read, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. What does that really mean? Does it just mean on a Sunday we don on our best bib and tucker, come into church, and we're holy? And then when we leave, we resume our lives. Sorry, could you pass my water? Because I should have brought it down. Sorry. Is that what it means? That we're only a Christian on a Sunday? That we're only called to surrender our lives and to live like Christ on a Sunday alone? I would suggest that's falsehood. We are called to surrender our life 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, and all the years that we are on this earth. We are called to surrender. So what does surrendering mean? Well, I would suggest it starts in we surrender our hearts. But it's much, much more than that. So much more than that. To be truly one with Christ, we need to surrender all aspects of our life to him, not hold on to anything. Now, I'm not saying that I'm advocating, like I heard some people, what sell like in the first century church, what sell all your goods and give it to the church. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is,
protection we receive, the holidays we take, the presents we buy, are all God-given. And God said to one of us today, I want you to give up everything you've got and go be a missionary in a far-off country. Yes, we would test that call. But if it proved that it was for us, would we surrender enough to do that? Or would we want to say, well, I don't really want to go there. I want to stay in the comfort of my own home and my own surroundings. Do we love Jesus enough to stand if he calls us to do that? You see, that's when Paul was confronted on the road to Damascus. You may have thought, why is he putting that? In a way, Paul on that day totally surrendered the rest of his life to God. I don't see how you couldn't, really, if a blinded man suddenly blinded you and you hear God actually speak. But Paul, even though he was a devout Jew, and let's not forget, he held the coats while they stoned Stephen. He was there. Yet he had a total 360-degree turn when he met in a real experience with the Lord Jesus Christ and was transformed. I had a friend who was like that. He was a brilliant jazz and blues pianist. I often say to some people, do you remember Emerson, Lake and Palmer? And they look at me a bit strange. But if you were around in the 70s and 80s, you'd have remembered Emerson, Lake and Palmer, a fanfare for the common man. And the guy who played it used three keyboards. Very complicated piece of music. And this guy, Phil, could do that. He could play that. He was that good. But his motto was sex, drugs, and rock and roll. That was him. And I played with this guy in a band, playing jazz, and we'd done different jazz festivals. I was all over Wales, Brecon, went France, went everywhere, playing jazz and blues. And all of a sudden, he disappeared. Just dropped off the face of the earth. Nobody could get hold of him. When he went to his house, he was never there. And then one day, I was walking into the local town in Tesco, the Conte Pool, and who should come towards me but the bed? I said, where have you been? Oh, well, he said, my hand is really bad. And I said, oh, don't give me that. What's the real reason? Now, this guy was a confirmed atheist. His father was a lay preacher. I had been. But he was a philosopher. He did a degree in philosophy. He told me he would break minds through faith. I just smiled when he told me that. But he really had, he looked at me and said, I don't want to play that kind of music anymore. He said, in fact, I don't drink anymore. I don't smoke drugs anymore. And I'm looking for a faithful partnership. I gave my heart to Jesus. And he said, I said, well, we'll watch your school. Because at that time I was looking for a church. We moved back from away and back to Pontypool, and I'd been to about 30 churches and I couldn't find a church. He said, oh, I go to Upper Trust the Baptist Church. I said, there's no such place. He said, there is. And we walked beside the Tesco. He said, there it is, hidden on the hill. He said, will you come to church with me? And I said, oh, I'm sorry. No, I can't this Sunday. And he went, oh, I'm sorry. I said, no. I just promised to go to, with friends, to a church. But I'll come the following Sunday. I, Jimmy. He said, oh, we wear a shirt and tie, he said, and suit. I said, okay. So I turned up in my best three-piece suit, you know, my tie on. And I walked into the church. There was about 10 believers there. And God said, you're home. just come from a church where I was worship leader, where if we didn't get in by 10 o'clock for a 10:30 service, you stood at the back. And you're bringing me to this? I said, you've got to be joking. I'm not coming here. And they had somebody on the piano, and all they used was Sankey and the Baptist hymnal. Nothing else. I thought, Lord, you've got to be having a laugh. But I went to the service, and it was, and I went home and prayed, and God confirmed, you need to surrender on this. I want you there. Well, it was a 4 o'clock service, and when I went there, it was a bit more lively. It was about 4:15. And they played a lot more lively music. My friend, Phil, who now is an elder of that church, was playing piano, and he said, will you bring your guitar along, and will you start playing and singing? I said, yes. That was the start of the journey of my surrender into ministry. I had to swallow something I didn't want to swallow. I thought, I'm not coming here, Lord. Suzanne Dean was a primitive Methodist, as they call it, where I said, I've got to a Pentecostal church. She said to me, oh, you've been to the Happy Clappers this morning. That's a Welsh thing, the Happy Clappers. And I was used to that kind of lively worship. And all of a sudden, the Lord said to me, surrender to my will and my plans for your life. And I did. And it led me on a journey which I never thought I would ever go on. But if we really want to see what God's got for each of us, then it's by surrendering to Him that it will come. There is no other way. We can't have our own little plans and schemes and our own little ways. It has to be Jesus, first, last, and always. And I mean in everything. We should consult with Him on everything. The amount of times people have looked at me crazy in the car, because I've been talking, and I'm in the car all on my own. And that was before we had all these fancy headpieces and mobile phones. And they must have thought, something wrong with him. But I was constantly talking to my Father. Getting to the wonderful way of being constantly in contact with God. Because He's waiting, He's listening. All we need to do to access that wonderful life. And I'm not saying things have gone wrong, of course they have. But I've had that assurance that I'm surrendering to God's will for my life. I'm walking the path that He has laid down. Not the path I wanted to go. I'm sure Paul, when he was on that road, what did he have? He had a number of warrants in his hand, didn't he? He was going to get more Christians to stone, to kill, to persecute. And what did Jesus say? Saul, why are you persecuting me? Basically, why do you not surrender to my will? Do we really think we know better than He who created the world, created the universe? Are we that arrogant that we think we know, that we don't need to consult God? We can make the decisions. I don't think we are. I think we need Jesus every single moment of every single day. And we need to be the people who are surrendered totally, completely and utterly to Christ. Jesus but to trust and obey. It's against human nature, my friend, for us to do that, because we become independent beings. We become separated from the love of God when Adam bit that apple. He caused a division. A division that was healed when Christ came. God has done all he can to draw his people to him. We need to do our part. We need to surrender to his will. Now, I'm not on about surrendering to the pastor, the deacon, or anything like that. No, no, no. I'm not all about church government here. I'm on about the ultimate government, God. That we surrender to his will for our lives. We set aside our plans, our dreams, and take on the plans and dreams that our Father has for us. There can be no other way, my friends. If we want to truly know the blessing of God, it is by first surrendering to him, giving our lives to him, and letting him guide us. I know it sounds damp, but we need to pray about everything and ask for guidance. Because if we want to, we might still make mistakes. But if we want to have a peaceful, blessed life with God, it's by surrendering to his will. Been a Christian now 45 years now. And I've rebelled. Oh yeah, have I ever. And then I've come into difficult times. My first word is, why did you let this happen, Father? And he said, listen, you knew better. He still made good out of that problem. But I would save myself a lot of heartache. You see, God never leaves us. I always imagine that God is like, we all know the footprints thing, but I think it was a step further. Jesus is here now holding our hands. But when we come to a crossroads in life, we can either see his guidance and his will, or we can go the other way. Now, Christ doesn't leave us, his hand stretches to be with us. But life gets harder and harder. He's still waiting at the crossroads for us to see, I'll come back. And then we go the right way. But why do we as mankind always want to do that? It's like Dorothy, isn't it, in the Wizard of Oz. Not Dorothy Sabbath. But Dorothy in the Wizard of Oz, when they're on the yellow brick road, they see the Emerald City, don't they? It's across a field. But the yellow brick road winds. And what do they say? Let's cut across. Come on, it's quicker, I can see it. And they get halfway across and they're lost. They fall asleep. Very much like us. When we don't surrender to our God, we fall asleep in a way that we're not listening to God. And we don't move on with God. I don't mean we literally fall asleep, but to use the analogy, if we want lives full of blessing, of love, of peace, Paul tells us, doesn't he, you know when you have peace, when you have peace in your heart. And the only way to ensure that is to surrender, as Paul did, to God. And as the proverb says, I've got to find his name now. Yes. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, commit to him, and he will make your path straight. When that word was given, it applied. Well, I can tell you it still applies today. And if we want to see peace, harmony, love spread, it is by being the people that God calls us to be. And that is by surrendering to him. So the final question is, will we do it? Amen.
Thank you, Mike, for some challenging words there for us this morning.
May they make us ever stronger in your family, God. May they says there is strength in his blood and his body. He says we will thirst no more, so come and drink. Be one with the Father and one with each other. I invite all who love the Lord Jesus Christ as their Saviour to partake in this family meal. We are one before God, one before him. On the night our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had blessed it, he broke it, saying, this is my body, which is broken for you. There is a supplement of bread. Get our bread if you wish it. Yes, thank you. Please stay there. I pretend there's nothing into you. I do this every time. Yes, I think it's different. The body of Christ. Body of our Lord Jesus Christ with his sacrifice to you. Let's pray. Oh Father God, may we never forget that you love the world, that you sent your Son to die, that you love us before we ever. That you allowed your Son to pay the terrible debt that was owed by us. Yet not did you let him die, but you rose him on the third day triumphantly. And now he sits beside you in your right hand side. May we ever be grateful, Father, for what you have given us and for all you do for us. We ask this prayer in the mighty name of Amen. And then we have the wine that was given and flowed for our forgiveness. When you receive this wine, means retain it, and we will share together as one body. Blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. God, the blood of Christ that flows for the forgiveness. The blood of Christ which washes us from the sins. Let us together drink and remember him who gave all that we might live. For he said, this is the blood of the new covenant. Drink and remember, for I shall not drink of this grape until I drink again with you. Let us drink now and remember he who gave all. Let us pray. We thank you for the blood that flows and washes us white as snow. For we know we have no righteousness of our own, save that that your Son gave each one of us when he sacrificed his life that we might live. Father, we pledge our lives to you, surrendering in love to you, for you who have given us all. We thank you, now and evermore. Amen. Yes. Sorry, I'm very, very confused this morning. Now we will take up our communion offering, which is used for the pastoral fund to help those who are without.
to share the pastoral news with you. We heard this week that Primrose was taken into the RD&E where they at first diagnosed kidney stones, but they now say, no, that's not right, it's muscular. She's in quite a bit of pain, so do remember Primrose in your prayers. We heard last week that Daphne is in hospital again, but I have no details to give you. As Pastor Mike said earlier, he has his operation this Friday, 9th of February, to have the corneal transplant and the removal of the cataract. And we remember Sue in her concern for Mike, and as she regains her health and strength. And Mike, we continue to pray for you. Please continue to pray for Rosemary. I saw her earlier this week and she wasn't too good, but Alison saw her yesterday and she said to tell us that she is a lot better. So that's a wonderful answer to prayer. And Sue Gazzard is very poorly too, and she values our prayers. And we thank God for answered prayer for Kay Bansey. She is now back home again, and her family are keeping an eye on her. Margaret, Carol and Alan aren't here today. Margaret is fine, but she went to a granddaughter's 21st birthday yesterday, and she didn't get home till 11 o'clock. So I'm sure Margaret was quite exhausted this morning. She sounded it when she rang me at 8 o'clock. And Carol's had a bad week. Please pray for Carol. She's not very well today, and that's why they're not here with us. And now Joe is going to lead us in our intercessory prayer.
Daphne, Margaret, and of course Pastor Mike. And we give thanks for the good news that came back to us now one time. There are so many other people in the fellowship that have good and bad news that have to need prayer or can rejoice in the Lord. Lord Jesus, we ask you to touch them right now, wherever they are. Bring healing to their bodies and restoration to their souls. And as we look to the future, may we receive a fresh vision from you for this fellowship. May the leadership of this church be filled afresh with your Holy Spirit. Grant us wisdom as we seek your direction for us as a fellowship. May we move forward together in you. May your glory fill this place. May your name be always on our lips and in our hearts. Amen.
Thank you, Jill. As Dorothy mentioned, Mike, the pastor, is going to operate on Friday. And so it would be nice as a fellowship if we can pray for him. So can I call the elders and the deacons to come together and let's lay hands on Mike and let's pray for him. Come to the end of our service.